Thank you guys for being here tonight. I'm hungry to be here tonight. I have some of my team here tonight. Tamara, you want to wave? There's Tamara, give her a big God bless you. Jennifer is my daughter. She's going to be running around with the camera. So wave, JV. Let everybody hear. JV for short. And Andrea is one of our Michigan prayer partners, deliverance ministers that helps us on the road. And Denise, some of you guys probably know her from Gilead Healing Center. Do some of you know her? Okay. They came to support us, and there might be some other of you here that snuck in, and I don't know if you're here. So forgive me if you're here, and I don't know that you're here, okay? So this is part of my team. The rest of my team comes in later this week because we actually are here also for a tent revival in Hastings. Yeah. So we're excited because we are partnering together for the region, amen?
Amen.
And the pastors here want to see what God, they want to be in union with what God is doing. And the pastor of the Hastings Assembly of God is here. Pastor Allen, do you want to just wave? Where is it? There he is. So you'll see us this week over at Hastings Assembly of God. That's July 14th through the 17th at night at 7 o'clock, I think we're starting. And so, yeah, we're excited about that too. But what we love about Michigan, guys, is God is really moving in Michigan. Really moving in Michigan. And this is one of my favorite places to come, one of my favorite states to come. And I had a word about Michigan back before the 2020 and all the things, and I saw snow falling over Michigan. Imagine that. Michigan never gets snow. I mean, wow, what a prophecy. No. It's... But I saw a beautiful dream without going into all the details. I saw God bringing that fresh snow over Michigan and that he was actually going to cause people just to fall into that snow. It was like people falling into the snow. There was like refreshing. And so I know that God is moving. And that's before we'd ever come to Michigan. And so I'm really excited to be here to partner with you guys for a revival tonight. I'm really super excited. So a real small thing about my husband and I and our ministry, which is called Contagious Love International. And I hope that it becomes contagious for you tonight. They tried to ruin the word contagious in 2020, but they didn't understand. We already had it. We've been in this ministry for 20 years. COVID, get over it. We're the contagious ones, not you. So for 20 years, my husband and I traveled the world, done mission work, and seen God move, you know, through crusades and Compassion Acts and just loving on people, preaching the gospel, wherever we could go, in schools, on streets, in churches, just anywhere we could go. We wanted to minister because we loved the Lord. My husband and I were both delivered out of drug addiction. I had a drug issue for 7 years of my life before I met my husband. God supernaturally delivered me of drug addiction. And my husband on another side of America was getting supernaturally delivered of his drugs. And God brought us together. Amen?
Amen.
For such a time as this, because there's no time to waste. We have to answer the call of God.
Amen.
And so we minister, we love the Lord. And there was a season where my husband kept ministering and traveling all over America and the nations to do, you know, preach the gospel. See, and he sees incredible miracles and the youth getting rocked, like the youth getting on fire. Who loves to see that? I love that. And we encourage the kids to be on fire and to be hungry for Jesus. And I stayed at home with my two children. I have an older, Genevieve's my daughter, but Samuel is my son. He's a couple of years older than her. And I stayed at home during that season to raise my babies because it was too much on them to just take them back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, jet lag and overseas. And I just said, I can't do this. My mama's heart cannot do this. Who knows what I'm talking about?
Amen.
You want your kids to feel stable and that you love them, you care about them, to have all the things they need. And that's a ministry.
Amen.
Because family is first.
Amen.
Amen. And ministry can be second. But we've got to take care of our family because God is about family.
Amen.
So it was a hard stretch for me, friends. I was used to traveling and ministering. And, oh, yeah, share it on Facebook.
Yeah, there we go.
Share it on Facebook. It's live on Jennifer Martin. It's also on you guys or no?
It's not right now.
Okay.
Yeah, it will be tomorrow.
Okay, it will be tomorrow, so you can wait tomorrow and share it. Or if you just can't wait, you can go to Jennifer Martin and share it. Okay, it's your choice. And so anyways... it was a hard stretch for me. I had to stay home And I cried a lot because I felt like, where's my calling? Where did it go? I want to preach, you know, but you sacrifice for your babies. But who knows what I'm talking about? You know that you would always do that first, but it's still hard to not do the things that you're burning inside to do. And it's like the Lord kept telling me, just wait. Amen. Just wait. I was like, okay, I only have to wait like a month, right? That'll be good. I'll sign up for the month-long plan. Okay, maybe a year? I can do that. Let's wait a year. No, the Lord's like, wait 15. Wait 15 years. Kind of sounds familiar from the stories of the Bible where you hear, you know, where Joseph waited. People waited for the answers for the Lord, right? And God is not always as fast as we want him to be. Sometimes he's long-suffering, he's patient, and he's working a plan, friend. So don't hurry him up. He's trying to get all the pieces in a row. And you don't want them out of order. You want them where they're supposed to be. So we're going to back off of God's plan. So we're going to take our hands off. And we're going to say, you know what you're doing. Yes, sir. I'll be happy to sit here and wait until you say go. Okay? So COVID hits 2020. So fast forward. Dale, I'm going to try to summarize this. COVID hits 2020. All of our invitations got canceled for that year because nobody was meeting. And so alongside a media ministry that God had given me to begin online on my Facebook, which God started using to really touch people, heal people, things like that. So I would just encourage people. And it was very powerful. But like maybe 15 people showed up. Maybe 20 people would show up online. And I did that for 3 years. How many people want to give up when you're like, oh, I don't think it's making a difference? Yeah. But God's watching. Are you faithful over the little?
Amen.
Because he wants to know if you can be faithful over one, you can be faithful over 10,000. Come on, somebody. Because God looks at the heart. Man looks at the outward appearance. Okay. So God looks at the truth and the inward part of our heart. So he watched me for 3 years while I ministered to that tiny group of people. So 2020 hits. It's been 3 years. All of our meetings get canceled. My husband can't travel to speak anymore. And we said, well, what are we going to do? I don't know. What do you want to do? I don't know what we want to do. And we're like, let's put a tent up. Okay, let's put a tent up. We didn't pray about it. We didn't really like wait for the confirmation. We were just hungry for God, amen, to go after revival. We're like, surely God wants a tent up on the side of a road, and surely he wants to save people and heal people. I don't think I need to wait for confirmation on preaching the gospel. Amen. So we did it. And the Lord, the day that we said yes to the tent revival, the Lord sent an anonymous person to give us a donation who had no clue, because we had only talked, my husband and I, with each other, had jumped in our car, drove to look for the spot for the tent, drove and said, where do we want it? Okay, maybe by a highway. So we looked at all these places, okay? We were dreaming with God. Who likes to dream with God? Amen. Come on, we were dreaming. And I was like, let's just have some faith. And then we get back home. And the second we got back home, guys, the largest donation our ministry ever received landed in our PayPal account. And the Lord said, bam, there's your tent money. Just like that. He's like, you'll dream, I'll provide for the dream. So you dream first. Provision comes after. He said he'll provide for what he told you to do. Did he not? So we did it. And so it happened in April of 2021. We planned 4 nights. And we thought this will be great. Preach the gospel. We'll see people get saved. We'll have a water baptism tank. We'll do all these things. It'll be great. It'll be wonderful. God will do miracles. And hallelujah, okay? So we show up and God moves powerfully. He moves very powerfully. Every night was powerful. And my husband spoke on night one. We had a friend speak the next 2 nights. And then I wanted to finish up on the last night. And so on the last night when I ministered, the Holy Spirit fell in such a way that I had never experienced in my life. And I didn't know he was going to come like that. I didn't know. I thought it was always going to be the way we saw it when we traveled. You know, a normal conference kind of thing. And God moves and his power comes. And we love that. But there's a deeper place. We're singing about it, right? go deeper still, take us into the love. There's a deeper place in the Holy Spirit that I discovered I did not know until that night. And I realized I had missed it for 20 years. I had missed it for 20 years. I didn't realize the Holy Spirit wanted to touch people so desperately until I watched him do it. And I fell on my face as little children were encountering the presence of God. They were crying. They were weeping. People were getting set free. People were coming and telling us that they were getting set free. I'm talking suicide, depression. I'm talking any kind of evil spirit or demonic oppression was coming off of people in the atmosphere. People were reporting to us, sickness is gone, disease is gone. They were being healed in the atmosphere. This was happening, and it was all the presence of God. And he wanted it, and he chose it, and the fear of God came on me. And I said, Lord, I'm so sorry that I've been in your way all these years. I didn't know. We just don't know, do we? We don't know. We're trying our best. We're trying to seek him. We're hungry, aren't we? We want him. And friends, I was crying out on my face for years that God would let me see a move of his spirit. Amen. That if I only got to see it for one day, that's okay. I'd see it one day, then I'd go home. The power of God moved so strong under that tent that I went home weeping my face off, and I said, I am satisfied. I literally did. I never thought I would say those words. I said, I'm satisfied. I can go home now. Nevertheless, the Lord wanted me to stay, and he said, extend the revival. He said, don't close it down. And we had to keep going, and we kept the tent open every day for that month. And we took some breaks in between, just a few days off so people could rest. And God continued to move every night. I thought, okay, it'll be that night. But surely that'll just be it. And there won't be, you know, and it'll just go back to normal. But night after night after night, I watched as the Holy Spirit moved. And I could do nothing but watch. And I didn't understand why I got to experience it. I'm just thankful that I did. Amen. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you that I earned the Holy Ghost. No. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you that I did something, that I fasted enough, that I prayed enough, that I, whatever that I needed to do to get God to show up. I didn't scream enough, cry enough, shout enough, sing enough, dance enough, whatever enough, give enough. Because I had done that for 20 years, guys. And surely if any of that worked, it would have already worked over those 20 years. Do you understand what I'm saying? But God doesn't look at all of our outward expression. He looks at the heart. And for whatever reason, he chose on that day to appoint a beautiful move of the Holy Spirit that to this day, since April 2021, we couldn't stop. We had to meet every week. A church opened its doors to us, and every week God continued to move with miracles, signs, wonders, and people being delivered of things. Whatever demonic oppression there is, I want you to know you can be set free of it. If the enemy's tried to oppress your life and push you down, I want you to know what I've been seeing is thousands of whatever you want to call it, deliverance, freedom, being set free, you know, whatever you want to call it. Jesus is doing this through the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And we're watching it happen. Thousands of testimonies that I'm watching with my eyes that I have nothing to do with. But God has chosen to partner with me. And it's a big honor.
Amen.
It's a big honor. Because I know the anointing is precious. It's not something God just freely gives away. Don't you understand? It's precious to him what his son did on the cross. I'm not supposed to preach yet. I'm supposed to just be giving an intro story. It's really hard not to just preach through it. It's precious. This, what God is doing, what he started last year in 2021 is precious to him. And it's his choice. And anyone that wants to yield to him, that is hungry, faithful, ready, and pure-hearted, you can move in the anointing. Yes. When it's not about you and there's no agenda and you don't want to do it to be seen or hold a microphone.
Yes.
Can I please help somebody?
Yep.
Don't. It's not glorious to be up here. It's hard work. It's physically taxing on the body. The warfare that comes with it is not something you want to experience. Unless you're ready to die and lay your life down. And then I welcome you to platform ministry. But it's not glorious, friend. Don't let it lie to you.
Amen.
This is the hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life. It'd be easier for me to stay home and get a full-time job. But I'm not going to do that. Why? Because God wants people free. He wants to touch people. And he wants them to know him, his presence, on an even greater level. So he chose in 2021 to begin to unleash another move of the Spirit. Has anybody noticed?
Amen.
It's been happening.
Amen.
Have you been noticing the ministries moving?
Yes.
Have you seen the rise in deliverance ministries?
Amen.
Is anybody familiar with it? Raise your hand. Are you familiar with deliverance ministries that's happening? Okay. So let's take a step back. What is going on? Has anybody asked that question? What is going on?
Amen.
Why is this happening across the board? And it's like, okay, why is there a move of the Spirit like this? In 2021, it was 400 years from the beginning of the birth of America.
Wow, yeah.
There's a story in the Bible about people being in bondage for 400 years. God's people. And then God speaks to his servant Moses. And he says, the cries of my people have come up before me. And I am sending you to deliver them. It's been 400 years, friends, for America. I think America's been in bondage long enough. I think the enemy has been manifesting, throwing a fit in the world, and especially in America, because he sees her day. And he doesn't like it. So he's throwing a little fit. He can get over it. Jesus is king.
Amen.
And God is judging the works of the enemy. He's judging the evil. So there is an anointing actually causing people to get free of things that they've wrestled their whole life with. Do you hear me?
Yes.
That should have made you excited. That should make you excited. And we're not seeing it turn off. So I need to explain something. As hungry as you are, as hungry God will move. I have seen the greatest outpourings of the Holy Spirit in places as I've traveled. And I've also seen a tiny outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Do you hear me? Everywhere we go where there is great hunger for the move of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit responds. Are you hungry? Do you want him to move tonight? Do you want to see more than you've ever seen? I do. I'm hungry for God tonight. I want to see him move in this place in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
Because he loves us, guys. He's for us.
Yes,
he is passionate for his sons and daughters to be delivered and set free. And he appointed the time. It began in 2021. It's continuing to happen. It is not slowing down. It is not stopping. I thought maybe it would slow down. Maybe it would stop. It's not stopping.
Yeah.
Everywhere we go, the Holy Spirit's moving. Everywhere we go, I watch him move. Everywhere we go, he just touches people. And it's wrecking me, guys. It's wrecking me after 20 years of ministry and never getting to see that kind of encounter that people are having with the Holy Spirit and getting to watch it every time. Do you understand how precious this is to me? The anointing is not cheap. It is costly, friends.
Amen.
Leaders know. It's costly to go after God.
Amen.
But it's all worth it. It's all worth it. On the other side of this thing, we get to hear, well done. Good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Don't you want to hear those words? So who cares if we sacrifice down here? Who cares if it's hard? That's what I say. Just keep plowing for Jesus. Just keep going for him. There's a reward for us in our faithfulness, whether people see us or not. I'm about to talk to you about that. Oh my goodness, I'm about to talk to you about this. I'm about to talk to you about what God sees that people don't see.
Amen.
But I need to pull my reins for just a minute. Mm-hmm. I need to pull my reins because I'm supposed to tell you that we've been traveling 2 times a month. Our schedule for 2022 was booked at the beginning of this year because people were watching the live streams and they saw what God was doing and the way he was moving and the freedom that was happening and the people getting healed and kids getting touched and just crazy things happening. People getting restored, marriages getting healed. Come on. Whole families getting totally set free. Teenagers getting on fire. Wait, hold up. I've got a revival testimony for you. A teenager who stopped playing video games. Now we're in revival. I knew it. I wasn't sure until then. But when that happened, I knew this was real. It's true. We're seeing teenagers get on fire and not only giving up video games and the things of the world, but doing a complete 180 and now preaching the gospel, leading other young kids to Jesus Christ, starting youth groups, going to youth camps when they could have stayed home, begging their parents to bring them, guess what, to revival every week. Don't tell me that's not revival. What's going on at that place that these teenagers are getting so wrecked? I don't know, the Holy Spirit. They're experiencing him. They're feeling him. They're getting set free. They're experiencing something real, and they want to taste it every week. Amen. And so God is giving this to those that are hungry, to those that want it. It is released in the Spirit. It is released to the people of God. All you have to do is say, yes, Lord, I want this. I want to be in revival. I want to run with this, Lord. I want to see hungry people. I want to see the fire of God. Lord, use my life. God, I'll lay down my life for you because I really, truly love you. And true love dies. True love dies to their agenda. True love dies to their ways. True love dies to their calling. Uh-oh. True love dies to everything and only wants Jesus. No desire for ministry. None. None whatsoever. The only desire we should have is for him. Do you know that?
Yes.
And then when you have desire for him, you could care less about the ministry because you realize how not glorious it is. You realize how glorious he is, and we already have everything we've ever needed. We didn't know. It was just right there in a whisper. We didn't know. Everything is right there already in your mouth. Jesus, I love you. You have everything you need right now. You don't need to pine after a calling that is an actual lower status than being a son and daughter of the Most High God. I'm telling you, when you get that revelation of, my goodness, I am a daughter of God, I am a son of God, and you just love being loved by him and loving him, and literally nothing else can take the place of that. It's true.
Amen.
That's right. See, she knows. Nothing else can take the place of that.
Amen.
And as soon as it does, God will remove it from you for a season so you can remember that's not your God. And then he'll put it back because you learn for a minute and let you taste your calling again for a minute. And then say, oh, wait a minute. Let me remove that again. Getting a little too into your calling and your anointing and all your gifts. I'm talking to somebody. I don't know who needs to hear this tonight. But then he comes back. See, and he keeps testing you because he's forming you. He's shaping you. He's waiting to see when you're ready. And he keeps letting you try, just like you keep letting your children try, don't you? You keep letting them try and you let them fail, don't you? You pick them back up. You put them back on the bicycle. You let them go back down the road again. You don't tell them to stop because they fell over. You let them try again, don't you? And God will always let you try again, and he'll keep doing it, and he'll keep testing, and there'll be a day, friend, when it doesn't matter to you anymore, and then he gives it to you. How gloriously upside down that is. Because you found your joy in him. And now he can trust you. You see how that works? So let it go tonight. This is for some people. Just let it go tonight. Let it go tonight. Let the striving go. Let all the things you're trying to go after in this life go. Because this life is a vapor. Poof, it's gone. And then we live forever in eternity with him. And that's what matters, is we get to sit with Jesus every day. You're not going to want to go preach to people when you can sit with Jesus. I've got news for you. Think about it. You're not going to want to go over here and do this calling when you have Jesus right here. Every day that you can sit with him. See, in heaven, you won't be pining after those things. Because the things that you're gifted with, and the things that you're passionate about, whether it's singing, writing, dancing, whatever things it is that you do, it was all created to love him with it. And when you leave this life and you live in heaven, you're going to be forever worshiping him with those gifts. And so, friend, you find eternal purpose when you worship him with your gifts here. And that is the final result of who you're called to be. That is it. You've obtained it. There is no obtaining some greater status other than sitting at his feet. Who am I preaching to? This was not my message, Pastor. It's not my fault. It's theirs.
Yeah, we're pulling it out of you.
I'm seeing God do something. This is what's happening in this move of God. God is taking this very message that I'm saying to you right now, and he's bringing his bride back to the gaze of his eyes. I don't want to look at anyone else. I don't want to look at the glorious beauty of my ministry. I don't want to gaze at it and worship it. You understand? I don't want to gaze at and worship my gifts and callings for him. I just want to look at him. And it's like, what do you need today, Lord? How's your heart? Can I love you? Is anything grieving you today? And he just wants somebody to sit and hear him, you know? And see, he's a person. Do you know that? He's a person just like you, his feelings just like you. We're made in the likeness and image of God, yes? So if we're made in the likeness and image of who he is, then that means he has like feelings. He has compassion, we get it from him. He has deep love, we get it from him. He can feel ignored. He can feel unheard. He can feel unseen. Do you know that? Do we want him to feel that? We would never want him to feel that. Not after what Jesus did for us on the cross. I feel the Lord's heart tonight. In fact, this has been on me for 2 or 3 days, and I know it's for you guys, and I'm hearing the Holy Spirit's heart for you. And I can hear him just saying how much closer he wants to come. That he wants it, that's not the problem. Do you want it? Do you want it tonight? Do you want him to come so close to you? It feels as if He's filling up your entire being. That his love fills your body. That his love fills your heart. That if you don't learn anything in this life, that you would learn that he loves you. Do you know it? Do you feel it here? Do you experience it deep inside that God loves you? You are not rejected. Why would he reject us when he made us? Why would he do that? Why do we beat ourselves up with condemnation? And we allow shame to come on our lives, and we let the devil lie to us and steal the joy of being a child of God. And I'm telling you that God is not angry at you. He is angry at the devil that is lying to you. He is so in love with each one of us because he made each one of us. We are special. We are unique. And what God is after, see, God is not after the kingdom of the world the way the world is. God's not after that. The only kingdom he's ever wanted is the one that's inside of you. Somebody should have quoted me on that. The only kingdom that Jesus has ever wanted to go after is the one inside of you. And if there's another kingdom there, it's going to make him fight for you because he's a jealous God. Amen. And the only anger that comes up in his heart and the wrath, and we talk about God's wrath and his anger, the only reason that gets stirred up is because there's another God in the way of his lover. Amen. Who knows what I'm talking about? Amen. You ever been through that in your life? And you had to deal with someone that you loved, being in love with someone else? It hurts. What did that stir up inside of you? Jealousy, anger, wrath. So if we're made in the image of God, we're made in his likeness, and we have those things because of love stolen, then why would God not feel that way when love is stolen from him? He is jealous over you. He loves you. Anything coming between you and him, he wants to remove it if you'll let him. The devil's job is to keep your face distracted from God. To keep your heart distracted from the Lord. That's the devil's job. To keep you from worshiping the living God. And what does he want? He wants people to come and worship him and his image, which literally is throughout the whole world. That is worshiping the image. It's when we go after the worldly ways. And we know God doesn't want it, and we know it's not right, but we keep giving into it. Why? Because we've just never truly been filled with the Holy Spirit so deeply. We've never been filled with the love so deeply that it did something inside of us. It wrecked us and it melted every other golden calf that we had in our lives. I know, I followed the world, guys. I can talk about this because I did it. It's my testimony. I grew up in church. My dad was a pastor. I got deceived by the enemy, and I left the one that loved my soul, and I hurt him. He is so innocent and so pure. The Holy Spirit is so pure. When Paul talks about don't grieve the Holy Spirit, it's because the Holy Spirit, he's so pure. One thought outside of a pure, lovely thought is going to grieve him. One position of your heart that is above his position is going to grieve him. One thing you watch or listen to from the world is going to grieve him because the Holy Spirit is pure and innocent like a child. He's full of love and unconditionally will lay his life down for you if all you'll do is give him everything. People don't know. Jesus is calling them. They just don't know it. So he's trying to get louder because they don't hear his voice anymore. He's got to create memes now or whatever so that people will pay attention to him. You know, we've even turned a lot of the church scene into the way the world's doing things and entertaining things, you know? But I feel the Holy Spirit drawing many of you in here into a redirection to the simplicity of who he is, the simplicity of Christ. You don't have to do anything but love him. Can I set you free in here tonight? It's literally, I'm going to tell you my story. Okay, I'm moving this anointing now. Maybe you'll see it tonight. I don't know what the Holy Spirit will do. I can't tell you that that's going to happen because it doesn't belong to me. You understand? So I'm not going to say there's going to be miracles. I'm not going to say there's going to be people getting set free. I believe that. I pray for that. I hunger for that. And I believe the Holy Spirit will do that. And let's see what he does, okay? Together. We'll open our hearts to him and we'll see what he does together. But I'm sure not going to tell you what he's going to do because he didn't even tell me yet. I just follow him like a wind, you know? He's like a wind. He blows where he wants. You can't control the wind. You can't give it an order of service. That's why people love me so much. Pastors love me so much. No, they love this anyways. But there's some places they're like, okay, tell us. How long do you need to speak? How long is this? And then this time, and then what? And I'm like, oh no, I don't know. Because the Holy Spirit never tells me, except in the moment, he directs me the way wind goes through the trees, you know? And I don't want to offend the Holy Spirit. You know, grieve not the Holy Spirit. And he is in charge. He is the head. You know, Jesus is the head of the church. The Spirit of God is in charge. He is the boss, and we are not. And the best thing I ever did was get dumb for Jesus. I sure did. I sure did, friends. I got so stupid, so like unknowledgeable in anything of God that it actually worked. Because I didn't know anything, he was able to move. Because I was just like, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to do church. I don't know. Nobody trained me how to do public speaking. Nobody trained me. I don't have any kind of skills in anything. So when God calls you, I know you told him you made a mistake. It must have been my neighbor. But thanks for believing in me, Lord. But what he's only looking for is a heart after him. Not eloquent speech. Not your amazing, you can play 20 instruments. Even though that's great. But God is looking, in all of that, God is looking for is your heart coming through what you're doing? Is your heart coming through your speaking? Is your heart coming through when you play worship? Is your heart coming through? Because man looks on the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. And it can't be fooled, you see? So I read the Bible and I realized God sees everything inside of me. So there's no point in hiding any of my junk anymore. He already knows. So let's just go ahead and get it all out. Yeah. Let's get the insecurity out. Let's get the pride out. Let's get the trauma out. Let's get the brokenness out. Let's just go ahead and let him have it because he knows everything inside of me. And I read in the Gospels and I read what Jesus did and I came to a conclusion that Jesus died to make me whole. And I got the revelation that I wasn't supposed to live my whole life broken, yes. Insecure, yes. Sick, oppressed, whatever it is. We're not supposed to have that as our life. Our life is supposed to be fulfilled. Amen. But it's only fulfilled when he is truly our God and not the spirit of the world. Because if there is a mixture in our bodies, our life, if we have more than one God, okay, then we're giving a right to those things, to manifest the fruit of those things. Does that make sense? I don't know who's redirecting my whole message tonight, but good job. But if you have God filling your temple, you have the Holy Spirit filling your temple, that means the fruit that comes out of you is going to be the Holy Spirit. Yes? So if the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, goodness, meekness, against these things, there are no law. And that is what is supposed to be manifesting out of our life. So if we can't look at our life and say that we're manifesting that, there is something else filling our temple besides the Holy Spirit. Right? And so if you let the Holy Spirit into your temple, what is your temple? Your body, your spirit, right here, you, who you are. If you let the Holy Spirit fill that place, he will actually drive out anything else that is not producing what he wants in your life. Did you know that? And this is why we have to stop thinking we're so great at everything and let the Holy Spirit be great. You can pray all day long, but until you yield to the Holy Spirit, none of that fruit is going to manifest through you. Did you know that? I have prayed for people, y'all, for I don't know how long. I've prayed for such a long time, nothing happened. And Holy Spirit be like, hey. can I have a turn? I was like, oh, yes, sir. Gracefully bowing out. And I'd be like, okay, fire the Holy Ghost. And then they get everything they need. There it goes. Oh, it was that easy. I didn't know.
Amen.
I started learning something. The flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing.
Amen.
And we don't know more than God. I'm trying to help some people tonight. We don't know more than God. So you might as well stop thinking you know more than God. Number one. Who is doing this, Pastor? Who's making me preach this tonight? Do you know? Fess up. Confess. I wanted to talk about the dark horses. And the dark horse youth that God is releasing. And the dark horse generation. Here it is. I was going to talk about it. Maybe we'll in a minute. How much time do I have? It's only 8 o'clock. Are you hungry? Is this helping? So the devil has been busy getting us fixed on what we know. And he started that in the beginning, okay? So Eve, he got her to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And now to this day, I see the same work, not only in the world, but also trying to infiltrate into the church world of just eating of knowledge. Knowledge, knowledge, knowledge. But where are the people that are going to come in and say, wait, I want to eat of the tree of life?
Amen.
I think I got some people in here that are hungry for the things of life.
Yeah.
And so we need to be careful. That even, Jesus said, even in the end times, the elect can be deceived. And that the enemy would try to come in and derail your life by keeping you pursuing knowledge and the things of the mind. Even about God. He's got people in a rat race reading books back to back, spending their whole life trying to learn the things of God, but never the things of the Spirit.
Amen.
The Spirit is not carnally discerned. It is spiritually discerned. And it's not language and words. The Spirit is the feeling that comes inside of you. When you're worshiping God, there should be a spiritual place that opens up inside of you. And it's like, I love you. I feel you. And it's not something you have to talk through. And God doesn't have to talk to you to get you to receive His Spirit. It's a spiritual, supernatural moment of the Holy Ghost coming in. Simply a breath of his wind can change everything. But do we believe this, friends? Do we believe this? That the wind of the Spirit can come in and by a breath change it? Because when we really die to how insignificant we are and even our words, and you realize how powerless we are, but how powerful He is, we're going to be quick to step aside and say, Holy Ghost, have your way. Move. And if you don't move, then I'm not going to sit here and try to force you to move. I'm going to obey your voice and follow you. I've seen more happen by simply yielding my abilities to Him. I don't try to break people through in prayer, because I actually have a deeper faith that the Spirit of God comes and breathes life, and then there was life. Do you see it? I'm not saying we can't pray. I'm not saying we can't partner with faith. I'm saying there's a greater place, a realm, where if we step aside and let the Holy Spirit come in, the miracles, the healing, whatever that is needed, the experience of His presence will come in. And God is doing this. I want to tell you something. I want to tell you why God wants to heal you, why He wants to deliver you, why He wants to set you free, and why He wants you to be whole. And it's simply because He loves you.
Amen.
And He doesn't like to watch you in pain. The Holy Spirit is very, very real. He is here right now. Do you feel Him?
Yes.
Do you feel Him when He drops on you? When He fills your heart, do you feel that anointing? Do you feel Him when He walks in? Do you sense His presence? Do you feel Him right now? Who feels the power of God? Who feels the power of God? Just show me. I'll lift a hand. You feel the power of God. Hands are lifted all over the room. What does the power of God feel like? Shout out some answers.
Heavy.
Heavy.
Reverent.
What else?
Peace.
Expectant.
Excitement.
Excitement. Warm.
Full.
Bright light. You feel light. Do you feel lighter? Do some people feel that?
Yes.
What about the kids? Kids in here. Kids. All you kids. What do you feel right now? What? Out of the kids, raise your hand if you feel the Holy Spirit. Out of the kids. Okay, I have two here. Is there more? There's more. Okay. How do you feel? Give me one word. Explain it.
Breath.
What about you? Peace. What about you? What do you say?
Freedom!
Woo! I like that one. What did you feel, son?
Happiness.
See? Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. You should feel joy when the presence of God comes. Who else?
Heart heavy.
Heart heavy?
Yes.
Like as in sadness?
No.
As in, explain.
Like it feels heavy inside of me.
You feel like a weightiness, like a pressure, like, okay, yes, I've heard it described that way. Who else you want to describe? A word that hasn't been said yet.
Awesomeness.
I really think the Holy Spirit likes that adjective that you just gave Him. I agree with that 100%. What do you feel, kids?
Joy.
You feel good. See, kids can feel the Holy Spirit too. There's no junior Holy Spirit. We watch kids get filled all the time with the Holy Spirit. And I know you guys do too, here, and speaking in tongues. And we're seeing a move for a youth revival happening in the earth.
Yes.
Any other kids wanted to say something? I didn't see you because it's really hard to see you. Okay, what else?
It feels sweet.
It feels sweet. I love it. Yes. Love it. Any other kids, you were trying to get my attention, I didn't see you? Is that it? Okay, I just wanted to make sure they didn't feel that I didn't see them. Someone else? No? Okay. So the Holy Spirit has a feeling. Okay, you can physically feel him when he shows up in the room, which means you can probably physically feel him when he's not in the room, which would be the opposite of these things. What would be the opposite of these things? Shout.
Pain.
Pain, chaotic.
Unawesomeness.
See the simplicity? There you go. I love it. Thank you, bud. Anger, right? Fear, anxiety, captivity, sickness, all these things, right? Everything not good, right? Everything not good, devil. Everything good, God. Amen. So kids, just put your hands up. And anybody else that wants to join them. I want the kids fully active with me right now. Just put both your hands up in the air. Okay. Now, the Holy Spirit, you're going to feel the Holy Spirit in your hands. So I want you just to pay attention. Tell me when you start feeling the Holy Spirit in your hands. Just move your fingers. Tell me. Do you feel that when you're moving your hand around?
Yeah.
You like this? We're doing interactive revival service tonight. You feel that? Okay, so I don't want to suggest. So what do you feel in your hand? Give me an adjective.
Tingly.
Tingly. That is one of the main words I've heard. Anyone else?
Unlimited energy.
Unlimited energy. Okay. So why are we feeling tingly? Why are we feeling energy in our hands? What is going on? What is the Holy Spirit? What is it about him that makes us feel tingles in our hand? Does anybody know? What'd you say? Power. What is God made of? Anybody know? God is?
Love.
And there's something I'm looking for. Light. Look at that light. No, don't. It's too bright. Stand up here and look at these spotlights. You won't do it. He knows. Pastor Jared's like, I never look at those things. I'm going to keep my vision. Okay, God is light like that. And what comes out of light? Pure power, electricity, right? So I try to help people because it's like God is real. He is a substance. We read about him. We believe him. We read the scriptures. Faith is a substance. You know all this stuff. Well, God is a substance. Faith is the spirit of God. So if faith is a substance and God is the spirit of faith, then that means God is also a substance. Amen? So you can feel him. And when you realize how real he is, when you feel that presence of God come on your hands, you realize he is in the room. He is moving right now. And it may not look like somebody's swinging from the cameras right now, but this is revival. The presence of God is revival. The presence of God is life. And he wants this. If you'll yield to it. I know it's hard to explain in words. That's why I'm telling you, while I'm talking tonight, will you spiritually discern God's heart right now, tonight, for you, and receive in your spirit what God is trying to download to you personally. And guess what? You don't have to have understanding. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm bypassing your mind right now. I'm speaking to your spirit man. Is this okay if I lost all of you guys? Is this okay? Okay, because the mind, hold on, let me help you. The mind is enmity against God. It does not have the things of God in mind, nor can it. So if I'm going to find God, I'm not going to find him here. Hello? What's going down into the dust when you go to heaven? You taking this thing with you? I'm going to get country on y'all. You taking this stinking thinking with you? You're not. So why are you listening to it now? The devil hates that I know this. He hates it so much. See, because I was very intelligent in school. I was top 10 of my class. I was in AP calculus, and as a junior, I was a very intelligent person. And God had to wreck me so that I could actually move in the things of the Spirit, because my intelligence was getting in the way, because I would analyze everything I saw, whether it was God or not God. And God had to wreck me, and he's like, where's your faith? You doubt so easily. This is what he told me. You doubt so easily. Why don't you just believe the same way you doubt? Oh, he got me. He said, you have a choice. You can choose to continually doubt my word, my power, my spirit, what I'm doing. And this was many, many, many years ago when this happened. He said, or you can choose to believe. He said, when you choose to believe, you will actually partner with me and create the substance that you're hoping for. And if we get this, friends, and we choose not to doubt, the Holy Spirit made me afraid to doubt. He said, every time you doubt, you literally counteract everything you did by faith. And he said, if you're going to believe, then believe. If you're going to doubt, then doubt. He said, pick one.
Amen.
I was like, woo! Okay, here we go. So I tried it. I was like, let's try it. It can't hurt anything to try believing, can it? So I tried it. And because I didn't think God could ever use my life. So he challenged me and said, stand in front of this person. I'm going to show you what I want you to say to them, and then you're going to say it. Because I didn't pray like that. You got to understand, I knew how to pray all the things. And I was reliant completely on my understanding of how to pray. But the Holy Ghost wrecked me and was like, you're not allowed to say anything but what I show you. This was a big stretch. He said, you can choose to believe or doubt. I said, okay, fine. I'm going to stand here. You're going to talk to me. I'm going to whatever, and I'm going to say it. So I did. I stood there, and I'm like, okay. And the second I said, okay, close my eyes, boom, a whole download, a vision, a word, all those things, like a movie started playing in front of my head. I'd never seen anything like this before. I didn't know there was such a thing as like getting things and words and visions and seeing pictures. And I got this and that happened. And then I tell it to her, and it's completely what she needed to hear. And she starts weeping, and I'm weeping because I'm wrecked. I was like, I didn't know you could just believe God.
Amen.
And just be dumb.
Amen.
It's okay to be dumb.
Amen.
And not know how to pray for someone. And then the kids love this. They're like, I don't need straight A's, Mom. Don't you see what the preacher lady's saying? Sorry, Mom. I'll try to disclaimer later. Go to kids. Go to kids. Go to school, kids. Get straight A's. I got straight A's. Okay? You can get straight A's. He said, what? You can do it. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God will anoint you to do that. Jesus saying. Believe. Believe in miracles. So he said, you can choose. And then he said, you can choose to do that every day, or you can choose to go back into Egypt and be full of doubt and not have the blessings of God and the promises of everything that I have for you that is available if you will just choose to walk in it, believe it, and partner with me. And so I made a choice that day that even though I had no talents, no knowledge, no whatever you want to call it, I felt the least of the least to be able to move in the Spirit, to be used by God. I made a choice that day to step into it, believe that whatever I heard and whatever I saw was from God, non-negotiable. Literally. And you know, he's never failed me once.
Amen.
Never failed me once. All these years later, every single thing he's ever gave me was exactly what was happening. Because I got my mind out of the way. I started spiritually discerning. And I chose to believe he would give it to me, not I would find it. I chose to believe he would give it to me, not I would strive and find it. Are you listening? I chose to believe he would give it to me. Because when he created me and he put the gifts in me, he put the talents in me, he put the heart in me, I chose to believe that if he wanted me to do things for him, because I love him, remember he's first, but because I love him, if he's asking me to go do these things for him, then I'm going to obey because I love him. Amen? And so if he is God, and we believe he is God, then he is so capable of keeping his word, anointing us, and using us. Amen? So I want to ask a question in here tonight. Will you choose to believe God?
Amen.
Even when it's scary?
Amen.
Even when it's hard?
Amen.
Even when the answers don't come back like you want?
Amen.
Even when the answer's taking way longer than you wanted it to?
Amen.
Will you still trust?
Amen.
Will you trust the verses that we quote, you know, that God is good? That he knows the plans he has for us, plans to prosper us, not to harm us, plans to give us a hope and a future. Will we really trust this character of God?
Amen.
That he wants the fullness of what is available to us, complete freedom, everything of the Spirit. He wants us to have it. He wants us to receive it. That's not negotiable. So what's the problem? The devil. And our will. Two things. The devil's one enemy, your will is your other. Don't you blame the devil when it's you. Amen.
Amen.
And Jesus already defeated the devil.
Amen.
With his blood.
And
what he is waking up in the church today, what I'm seeing happen, is that the faith of God is coming on the church right now to actually believe him.
Amen.
Actually believe him.
Amen.
This is awesome. We're looking around and we're seeing faith in God's people.
Amen.
They believe for miracles. They believe for breakthrough. They believe for God to answer. They believe for God to come. They believe for God for freedom. Because why would Jesus pay such a high price just to leave us in the dust and say, hope you make it?
Come on.
He paid the highest price. He went through the most horrible death. Let's not dishonor
Amen.
What Jesus did
yes.
by not receiving the fullness of the resurrection power
yes.
that he gave us. Come on. His kingdom is to come on earth as it is in heaven.
Yes.
And any other kingdom that is not his kingdom needs to leave.
Amen.
No more toleration, guys. And it's not just about America. It's not just about the world. It's about the individual heart. God's looking at the heart.
Yes.
And any other kingdom that has been against your heart or in your heart, guys, these kingdoms have to come down. Are you listening?
Yes.
We will give account of our life. Can I say something hard for just a second? We will give account of our life. We will give account of harboring unforgiveness,
yes.
bitterness.
Yes.
You cannot be saved if you have unforgiveness in your heart. You cannot claim Jesus as your Lord and stay in unforgiveness against a brother or sister and think that he will let you in. He wants to let you in, but he can't according to his law. Do you understand that God is a God of law?
Yes.
He made the way out through his son.
Yes.
But his son, through his own mouth, gave us what the law entails as he walked the earth. And if we read our Bible, guys, we read the Gospels. We have got to read the words in red, and we have to take it serious and stop listening to a hyper-grace message out of a lot of the churches today.
Yes.
That is saying, it's fine, it's fine, it's fine. Jesus paid the price, it's all fine.
Preach
Well, I don't understand how we can love Jesus and look at him bleeding on a cross and then go get drunk. I don't understand that. I don't understand how we can see Jesus do that for us, forgive us of our sin, and then go and turn around and not forgive someone who committed sin against us. And we harbor unforgiveness. I know, I did it, so I can talk about it. Okay? I'm not pointing any fingers. I didn't already point at myself. I've been through the wine press. I've been through the oil press. I've been through all of that stuff. I've judged myself. The Bible says judge yourself, right? Yeah. I've judged myself. I want you to know that. I keep myself under that every day. That if there's anything in my heart that would grieve God, I want it gone. I don't want anything to grieve the Holy Spirit. And I don't want his presence to go from me. And a lot of reason why people are staying sick in the church, the Bible talks about they discern the Lord's body wrongly. They wrongfully discern his body. They don't understand what it actually means to be in communion with the Lord. It's you turn away from sin. You don't stay in the world, guys. We can't do it. We can. We have to talk about this.
Yes, amen.
We have to talk about this. We have to talk about that if we continue in the ways of the world and keep walking after the gods of this world, then the gods of those world we will serve forever.
Yes.
Whatever God you serve in this life, you will serve forever.
Yes.
Okay? This is real stuff. We have to talk about it. Okay, I'll just stay here for just a minute because you have to know this. God is not a compromising God. You might want him to be. It'd be so much easier if he was. But he's not, and I can't change him, friend, and you can't change him, friend, and this life is going to end, and we're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ.
Yes.
And if there's anything in our heart, guys, anything in our body that is a sinful character or nature that the Holy Spirit told us to get out and we refused him, after he convicted us over and over, he will weep, he will cry, he will fall down on his knees while he has to tell people to depart from him.
Amen.
He doesn't want it. You understand that? He's pleading. He's pleading with this generation. Look at the darkness that has come in this world today. Don't tell me the enemy is trying his last plot to get as many people to fall away from God as he can. Don't tell me he's not doing that. You know what he sees? He sees a great harvest. He sees a righteous movement rising up in the church. The devil knows it. He knows his time has come. And he knows his time is coming for his eternal damnation. I'm telling you right now. And he is throwing a fit like a toddler tantrum before his last grounding. That's what's happening. He is throwing a big fit. And the power of the Holy Ghost is on the church. And God promised us, didn't he promise us in his word, that the church was going to see his light rise on us.
Amen.
Yeah.
But you see, that's going to come on a pure bride. You see what's happening? God is purifying our hearts. He's purifying his bride. And what we're seeing in this power of God that's coming, it's an actual cleansing revival. It's literally a washing and cleansing revival. God is cleansing people of the junk in their temple so that they can be purified and spotless so that when Jesus returns, they'll be ready.
Amen.
We'll have our oil. We'll have our lamps. Our garments will be white.
Yes.
Because the Holy Spirit already came first. And he's doing it now. Here he is. And he's reminding us, don't be fooled by the deception of the world.
Amen.
There is a God who loves you, who has provided for you the way out of being judged for sin. And all you have to do is, guess what? Believe, turn from the darkness, and walk after him. And I want to tell you, I've never partied so hard in my life until I came to the Holy Ghost. I want to tell you something. You think partying's fun, you think drugs fun, drinking's fun, you think all that stuff is fun, that the devil's trying to counterfeit and steal what God is actually doing, and you actually come and get filled with the Holy Spirit, you've never felt anything like the Holy Spirit. I'm talking filled with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Not little goosebumps. Not like, oh great, I feel little tingles. I'm talking about all the way in filled with the Holy Ghost. Who knows what I'm talking about? Does anybody in here know what I'm talking about? Amen. I know you guys do. This is the way to overcome the world. We get filled with the Holy Ghost. Not more knowledge, guys. Please, if you do anything, please don't get filled with more knowledge. Get filled with more Holy Ghost. Get filled with more Holy Ghost. He will wash out the things in your life that need to come out. You're like, how am I going to do this? How am I going to get free? I'm trying to tell you, you don't do anything. You don't do anything. You yield. You feel. You let Him feel. You let the Holy Ghost come in and say, Lord, I've been angry and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've been depressed and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've been jealous and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've had fear and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've had pride and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've had addiction and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've wanted drugs and I need freedom.
Amen.
I've been insecure and I need freedom. I feel rejected and I need freedom. And God wants you to have freedom, friends. It's not He chooses some and then He chooses others to not be free. I'm sorry for the times that the devil lied to you and made you feel like God wouldn't come through for you. He will. He will come through. He is faithful. He has a plan. He has a way. He will answer. He has an appointed time. You've got to grab onto that hope of who He is. And you hold on to it. And you don't let go of hope. Whatever you do, listen to me in here. You do not let go of your hope in God. Don't you do it. Don't you let go of your faith of what He can do.
Yes.
Don't you let go 1 minute of what God can do in your life and through your life and for your family and for those around you. God is a good God and He will do it.
Yeah.
The oil of the Holy Spirit is looking for vessels that will turn from the world and let their hearts become purified. And be completely His.
Yes.
It's all He's ever wanted.
Yes.
It's all He's ever wanted. And those that are completely His and they're filled with the Holy Spirit, they're going to have an anointing move out of their life and they don't have to scream it. I can scream. I get loud. But I'm saying you don't have to. The anointing comes from the Holy Spirit, not from my mouth, not from my volume, not from me, but from Him through me. He wants the pure oil, friends. Are you hearing me? He wants pure oil. He doesn't want mixture. Anything in your life that is exalted up above God and who He is has to be brought low.
Yes. Yes.
God desires the truth in the inward parts. He just wants you to get real with Him, okay? You get real with Him tonight. You get real with Him tonight and you let God touch you. If you'll only believe tonight, I'm telling you, it doesn't matter if you've been depressed for 20 years. I want to tell you something. We are seeing so many testimonies that if you knew all the testimonies that we are seeing, I need to, I guess, give some of those. Thousands of people set free. We've been seeing demonic deliverance. Is anybody aware of that happening in America? Like, actually, things coming out of you. Okay, so we've seen that. I'm not saying it's going to happen or whatever. It may or may not happen. But we've seen, as we've gone through the world, especially people that are heavily addicted, like heroin addicts getting set free of demons.
Amen.
You know, we're seeing people that were smokers. And there's probably smokers. There might be smokers in here. Listen, there's no condemnation, but I want to tell you something. It's not a clean temple when you're smoking. So can I help you? We've seen smokers of over 40 years, and this has happened multiple times, not just one story. 43 years of smoker, 40 years of smoker, 50 years of smoker, daily, half a pack a day, set free, one night.
Amen.
One night.
Amen.
How do we know they're set free? They came back the next two nights, said they hadn't had a cigarette.
Praise God.
Better believe that's a miracle.
Amen.
Anybody that used to smoke every day knows what I'm talking about. I was a smoker, and I got set free after 7 years of smoking one day. So I have faith for it. God did it for me. He'll do it for you.
Amen.
I wasn't worth that miracle. I'd just come out of bars and drinking, getting high every day. And I said, Holy Ghost, if you can set me free, set me free. He was like, okay. Did it the next day. I was like, oh. I didn't know it was going to actually happen. Because I said, if you can set me free, I'll serve you the rest of my life. He's like, deal. Hallelujah, I'm so glad he did.
Amen.
I got wrecked from day one, friends. Our God is a God of the impossible. He does the impossible and he makes it possible.
Amen.
Come on, do you hear what I'm saying? We've seen people healed of all kinds of things. I've watched tumors shrink before my eyes. It wasn't me, it's God. It happens in the meeting. People in their seats getting miracles. I have nothing to do with it. Not one of them did I lay hands on. The Holy Ghost did.
Amen.
Because see, he's a spirit.
Amen.
He has no limitation.
Amen.
He can go right into your body right there in your seat. Doesn't need me to bop you on the head with a hand. And I'll do that. That's fine. We can do the fire bop party or whatever. We can do the bop the heads. Okay? But what I'm saying is we don't have to.
Amen.
Because if we go deeper with our faith, God is so gracious that if that's what we believe, he'll do it. Did you know this about him?
Amen.
I've literally gone in some places, no miracles happened. And then I realized later it's because they believed they had to have a hand on them. So the Holy Spirit's like, you got to call them forward. They got to have a hand on them. I was like, okay, that's fine. Call them forward, put the hand on them, all the miracles start happening. I'm like, Lord, that's not as easy. He's like, well, the people have to believe first.
Amen.
And he's so generous and precious and gentle that he will work with you where your faith is. Did you know that? And guess what? He's not condemning you over it.
Amen.
Just like you don't condemn a two-year-old that they're not driving a car yet.
Amen.
Hello. So I want to set people free. It's okay to be where you are.
Amen.
So believe God where you are tonight. Are you hearing me? I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost is setting the stage for some people.
Yeah. Amen.
That he is highly expected of setting some of you free because I feel your faith coming up. And God's going to move. And we won't be that much longer. I know you might be used to kind of like closing. If you have to go, it's okay. But I want God to move.
Amen.
And I want to move into ministry time.
Amen.
And I want to give the Holy Spirit the platform. Is that okay?
Amen.
Sometimes we have to talk for a minute so we can get to a place. So we can get to a place.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying?
Amen.
Only believe. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Flush the doubt out.
Yes.
Don't even choose to think it. If it starts coming up in your mind, do you know how to push thoughts out?
Yeah.
I want you to do that tonight. And when people are praying for you, I'll be praying for you. Tamara will be praying for you. We have some people that will be praying for you. Denise and Andrea, you guys can be working with us. We're praying for you, or however the Holy Spirit wants to do this. I don't know how he's going to move it. But I'm asking you something. We normally do our revival nights till 1 a.m. And I just want to say something. If you're hungry and you stay, it gets better. Nobody knows this. Shh. I wasn't supposed to let the secret out. But the people that stay
something special happens in the anointing because of their hunger. God responds to hunger.
Amen.
You better hear me.
Amen.
God is real, guys. He is so real. And we're going to see Jesus if we depart from the ways of this world. Follow Christ. Believe in the power of the blood that was shed for you. Believe it in your heart. You don't need to answer an altar call to get saved. Did you know that? Oh, I'm really going to mess it up now. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, you shall be saved.
Amen.
That's all it takes. Turn from sin. Believe him. Follow him. And if you believe him and follow him, it looks like something.
Yeah. Yeah.
You start reading the Bible and you obey the commandments. You obey the word. Amen,
right.
Pastors.
Right.
Yeah. We have to obey his word.
Amen.
It's not grievous. It's freedom.
Amen.
The more you obey him, the more free you get.
Yes.
People don't know it. The devil doesn't want you to know it. He whispers and he tells you following Jesus is boring. Following Jesus is rules. Following Jesus is all this stuff, you know, is bondage. And I feel like I'm in chains. He is lying to you. Because when you obey Jesus and come to him, the Holy Spirit comes on your life in a way that you never experienced. Because he doesn't want to mix with the world. I wish somebody would get this. He doesn't want it. He doesn't want to feel a dirty temple. But if you're serious about serving Jesus and you want to be his forever and you want to love him and you want to know his love and you want to be his bride and you want to live with him forever, whatever he says, you want to do it because you love his heart. And if that's true and you've struggled with something, the Holy Spirit will come immediately to your rescue. Because he knows the heart. He knows if you're faking or if you're real tonight. So I'm not doing fake altar calls. Are you listening?
Amen.
You don't have to look like you're hungry. Either be hungry or don't. Pick one. You're either hungry or you're not. Pick one. Pick a side. Which team you on? I'm messing with y'all. Amen. I feel the Holy Spirit, and he told me this for the past few days, wants to encounter you tonight. And he wants you to encounter him.
Amen.
Even more. Even deeper. All the way to the inward part, all the way down. In every place of your life where you haven't let him in, he wants you to let him in tonight, and he's asking permission because he doesn't force himself on anyone. If you want the Holy Spirit to set you free, you have to invite him in, and then you have to let him. So tonight, as we enter into his presence in just a few minutes, be ready to open your heart.
Amen.
We're going to make space for him. He's going to come in. There's going to be a precious anointing that's going to come in and touch your heart.
Amen.
And the music's going to play. And God's going to whisk you up for a moment into his heart to set you free. It's okay to respond to God however you need to respond to him. You can laugh, you can cry, you can kneel, you can sit, you can stand, you can worship. You can be broken, and God is not offended at you. You can be in pain and cry the pain with him, and God is not offended at you. most beautiful move of the Holy Spirit that I've been watching. And we've been witnessing all over America, all the states that we've been going, all the miracles, all the deliverances we've seen, all the children getting set free, all the people getting saved, all the testimonies that are coming forward, all the freedom that I'm seeing. It's the most beautiful thing in the world. I came here tonight, that if just for a minute, maybe something, maybe some moment, you would let go of the pain, the trauma, just whatever it is that has kept you, and that you would be free. That you have permission here tonight to let those things go.
Amen.
So that you can live a life full,
yes,
of the Holy Spirit,
yes,
full of His joy.
Yes.
And knowing that you're loved and being free from the bondage, the imprisonment of the world. We don't have to live in it. I am a testimony standing in front of you. I could pull so many testimonies, Tamara's testimonies, Andrea. I could pull so many testimonies in front of you of the people that have come through the revivals as we've traveled, in the stories we get, the emails we get. And only God could do this. You understand? Only God could do something like that. And I read it. And I say, I don't know why I get to do this. It's so heart-wrenching. Especially going in places where their hearts are so broken and God is so wants to touch them, and I can see His heart for each face and how desperately He wants to touch them, but they don't believe it. And I leave crying. I love the stories, but it's heart-wrenching for His children that don't see Him. You know, when Catherine Coleman would see so many miracles in her meetings, do you know the people that were with her said they would find her in her office weeping after the night? And she was crying out to God saying, why? Why are they not all getting healed? We're thankful for what He does, but we also must be burdened for the ones that are under oppression. And I have a burden for that. And this is why we go. This is why we come to people. It's not so I can be seen and speak on a microphone and people see my words. I could care less about it. It's so you and Him can dance.
Yes. Yes.
I just want to get out of the way.
Yeah.
If I could just step into a room, the Holy Ghost just take over everything. That's the heart of the leaders. We don't have to be seen. We want Him to be seen. And I'm sorry that the kingdom of God has not looked the way that God has wanted it to look. But the good news is, He's creating a bride.
Yes. Yes.
That doesn't want to look at other people anymore.
Yes.
She wants to look at Jesus.
Amen.
We want to look at Jesus. So whatever this is that God is doing across America, whatever this is, I just think it's beautiful. I just think it's amazing. And I want to do it as long as I can. And we'd love for you guys to help us, you know, if you can. Help us however you want to help us. Pray for us, or you know, partner with us, or however you guys want to help us and send us. We love that. We appreciate that. Thank you, Jesus. Before we move into ministry, because we want to have plenty of time to do that, I just want to make space for those that would like to give and help us tonight. Pastor, if you want to share about this, because we just want to give an opportunity, you know, for people to partner with us, because we came from the last city because people are helping, you know, and that's just how it works. And you guys know, and I don't need to do a spiel. But the most important thing about this is I just want to ask you, as you give, that you would just honor the Holy Spirit. It's not about us. It's not about amounts. I could care less about the amount. Ask my team. Literally, do I care? I don't care. It's about honoring the Holy Spirit. Honoring the Holy Spirit. And what he has, guess what? Given to us. Us. All of us. Get to partake and drink of this anointing and this move of the Spirit. And it's like, I want to honor that. And I just want to ask you guys and invite you guys to honor the Holy Spirit by just blessing and pouring into what he's doing. Amen. Amen. And then I want to move into ministry, but it's going to get messy, so.
Yeah.
Amen. Right. Thank you, Pastor.
We want to sow into what God's doing. And, you know, when I'm looking into everything that goes on in our culture, I just want to say, you know, revival is always counterculture. And I want to sow into that because I'm not submitting to the spirit of this world. We're submitting to God.
Amen.
So we're going to sow into that tonight. So get your gift ready. I believe in what God's doing through Jennifer, through Contagious Love. Now, you can make your check out to Journey Life Church, but put it in the memo, Contagious Love or Jennifer Martin. Everything that gets in the offering tonight is going to them anyway. So if you're giving online, there's a drop down that says guest speaker. So you can give online, journeylifechurch.com. You use that guest speaker on our website. And so we're going to give tonight. Ask the Lord what he'd have you give and be obedient. We did the same thing and we're being obedient and we're wanting to sow in. As counterculture Christians, that's what we do. We sow. Time of economic uncertainty, we sow. In the time of famine, Isaac sowed. Reaped 100 times, 100-fold. So that's what we do. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to give right now. We want to be generous like you are. We want to become more like you in this area of giving. I pray blessing on every gift, every giver. God, I declare that your move would happen in us. The freedom. She said, God wants people free. So God, we want to be free in this area of giving. We want to be free in every area that you would call us into right now. We thank you for freedom. Thank you, Jesus. We give freely. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to bring our keyboard player back up right now and prepare your hearts.
Can you just bring it over there? They'll pick it up.
It's about to get real fun in here. I can feel it. I can sense it. Not that it hasn't been fun already. There's another level. Do you know that? There's another level. Thank you, Jesus. If it takes you a little bit longer to get your gift together, we also have boxes on the wall in the back of the room with little slots, and then you can give there. I'm gonna have to give there.
are going to stay. Everyone else had to probably go home. Some people have kids and you have to go home early, and that's fine. But the Holy Spirit can do a quick work. We can start ministry and be done in maybe less than an hour. I'm not maybe going to keep you here till 1. You know, I'll let them kick you out. I'm not going to do it, but stop by the book table on your way out too, because I wanted to talk about this. I wish I had a whole weekend with you guys. This is super important. I was like, I'm going to talk all about the dark horses. And God completely rerouted my message, which he likes to do. And that is, I'm fine with that, because he has to have his way. But a dark horse just means a hidden one, unseen, causing great influence. Okay? A hidden one. Everywhere. And they're everywhere. And God showed me a dream about a whole army of hidden ones, of dark horses coming forward, causing great influence. And you guys are part of that army if you want to volunteer. Amen. Okay, would you just stand with me? And just those that want to, if you want to come forward to the front, and let's just press into the heart of God. I might pray for you. It might be that the Holy Spirit prays for you. I don't know how this is going to happen. I want to tell you something. God wants to meet with you, like for real, for real. Like for real right now. And I want you not to look at us. I don't want you to let us lead you. I want you to let the Holy Spirit lead you. Are you hearing me? We might go one direction, you might go another direction. That's okay. Let the Holy Spirit touch you. Let the Holy Spirit minister to you.
Oh, Thank you.
setting you free. All that pain that you've been carrying has to go ahead and come out. It has to go. Give it to him right now. Let it go. Right here in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, go down deep into every person. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. See his face. Go down deep into every heart right now. Everything out of you has to leave so that what is of you can remain. Holy Spirit, shake it. Shake it right now. Holy Spirit, shake it right now. In Jesus' name. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken so that what cannot be shaken will remain. God is healing people right now as people are getting touched. God is healing people right now. People are getting free, heavy weights are being lifted from your heart. If you feel that release of crying, weeping, laughing, whatever that is, don't get in your head. Get in your heart. Get in the belly. The belly of the man is where the spirit is. Go with your belly right now. Connect to it. What's it feeling? What's it saying? Is it wanting to release that hurt? Is it wanting to release? You don't want to hold on to that hurt anymore. The Holy Spirit's trying to pull it out of you right now. He's got his hand on your head. He's pulling the pain out. He's pulling it out. Go with it. Let it all the way out. Think about every piece of it that's hurt you. Think about it and think about Jesus taking it on that cross. Think about the blood of Christ taking that pain right now. He wants to take that pain. He's got his hand out to you. He's got his hand out to you, and he's trying to take that pain from you, honey. He wants to take it tonight. He wants to take it from every one of you. Let Jesus have it. Let him have it. Let him have it. Let him have it. Let him have it right now. Showing you my goodness, and I thank you. Holy Spirit, we love you. Holy Spirit, we love you. Jesus, we love you. Lord, you know every pain in this place. You know every place. A bondage in this place. You know every evil work of the enemy that has tried to hold your people in bondage. Holy Spirit, I'm asking you now to judge those things and to bring deliverance to your children from the things that have held them. Right now. Praying, no one singing. who don't understand that. No one praying, no one singing. Connect. Thank you.
specifically instructing me not to. So out of the fear of God, can we pause the praying for just a minute, please? The Holy Spirit is here. He's here right now. Let's have the fear of God.
Get the fire.
Yes, Lord God. Yes.
Thank you, Lord, because they waited.
Yes.
They're receiving a baptism of fire right now.
Yes.
Jesus' name, from their head to their feet. There it goes. And if there's things in you that needs to be burned, that fire is going to start burning it, friend. You can yield to that fire. Some of you, that fire is starting to burn things. Insecurities, doubts, reasonings, thoughts. God's highlighting things right now that he wants out of your temples. And if you'll let that fire into that place willingly, and you don't hold God back, and you don't resist him, let it in. Let it in. Let the fire into that place. Let it into that place in your heart. Let it into that place in your head. Let it into that place in your life, and let the fire burn it. Watch his fire burn it. Let him in. Visualize him consuming those things with that fire right now. And let it go all the way down into the reaches of who you are. Even to the deepest places of trauma and pain and brokenness in your life. God wants to take out the wounds. The fire wants to take out the wounds. It's the fire of the Father. It's the fire of the Father's heart. It's the fire of the Father. It's the fire of his love. He's going to go into those wounds right now. He's going to take that trauma out right now. He's going to take the places in your life that were void, that should have had love and didn't get love. But God wants to put love there. And he's going to love you like you were loved every second of your life that you should have been loved. God's going to put love in there right now. Let him in. Let him in. Let him in. Let him in. The places that are empty, where you need that love, where you need that affirmation, where you need that attention in your life, where you need that friend or father or mother or sister or brother, let the fire of God's love into those places. He is the only one that will satisfy your soul and take that pain. Let him in, friend. Let him in. Let the fire in. Let it burn it. Let it burn it once and for all. Let it burn it out. I feel it happening right now in the spirit. There are people getting healed from trauma, deep wounds from your childhood. The Holy Spirit is taking those out right now, 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 right now. Every pain leave. Every memory of pain leave. Every place of torment leave. Every place right now. Every memory. Every wound. Every empty place. Every void. I call it up now. I call you up and out of them. I call you up pain. I call you up trauma. Up and off of them now. Out of their minds. Out of their memories. Out of their hearts right now. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Everything that has broken your spirit, I judge it now. In the name of Jesus Christ, let the fire of God judge those things that broke you. And let the fire of God come in and heal you. Thank you. Fire all over you right now. Just let it burn. Let it burn till it's all the way released. Holy Ghost, scoop it up. Go all the way down. Scoop up the pain. Take it in your hand. And scoop it out. Scoop it out of your babies. Scoop it out of your daughter. Scoop it out of your son. No more pain. No more torment. No more anguish of your soul. No more dark night of the soul. This doesn't have to be, friend. In the Holy Spirit, there is peace. Be filled with the Holy Spirit every day. Every day, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Invite the Holy Spirit in. Invite him to come in and fill you every day. You can lift your face. And be real with God and invite him into those moments. Invite him into those times. Invite him into the words that hurt, that were spoken to you to wound you. God is pulling out word curses out of you right now. Every word curse, every arrow shot at you, I pull it out now by the Spirit in Jesus' name. I cut it at the root. I command word curses to fall off of your life where they've brought in heaviness, where they hurt you, wounded you, and you took it in through your ears. And I pull those word curses out from your ears. And I pull the pain out that were attached to those word curses. I command that to leave now. Get under the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm healed right now. Let that go. Let it flow. If you have the tears coming, don't pull it back. Yield all the way into it. And just let the cries out. Many of you, the physical healings have happened. God showed me he was healing people physically. There were people that left here with physical healings. And we didn't have a chance to take a testimony because the Lord wants center stage. So you're going to have to understand something. The Lord wants center stage. So the testimonies are actually going to come in. Some of you tonight, as we're closing up, I want you to tell me or the pastor or our team that pain left your body. A miracle happened. Let us capture the testimonies. Come tell us what happened so we can make a note of it or anything. Check your bodies. I'm telling you. Ears are being opened. Hearing issues, especially with the left ear, is being healed in Jesus' name. God has healed many conditions tonight. Us to look at his face and not his hand, then that's what we're going to do for just a minute. The Holy Spirit is enough for you to heal. He's enough. He really is. Ask me right now. You're saying, Lord, I didn't feel the fire.